the same thing that we have heard echoed. She said, and I'm not just speaking for my house, although my house was affected. She said, I'm speaking for all these clients that come through here that I hear what they are saying and what has gone on. And praise opens the gates to even come before God. Enter his gates with what? If you can't get that far, then God is not liable to speak to you. Because what he has to say is too precious, and he wants to know that you want to hear it. And so you must put forth an effort. Amen. You must put forth an effort to come before him into his presence and to honor and respect him. That's why I don't think we should come before the Lord just any old kind of way. Because I don't go nowhere looking any old kind of way. I want to represent Pastor Craig and my own self well. And if I'm going to go before the king, I certainly want to look my best for him when I go before his presence. You know, sis, if I'm not in my own self's bedroom and we're not communing there. But if I'm going to go represent him, if I'm going somewhere to assemble and meet, then I want to offer him the best that I have. I want to put on the best that I have and look good for him. God wants us to look good. I want my children to look good. I don't want them being towed down. And if they're about to leave out and they're looking a little strange, I say something to them. And they may look at me. I said, hey, you represent me. So I need for you to, you know, do like that so they know you're well taken care of. Amen. So when we come before his presence, we first have to enter with thanksgiving and get past the gate. You just in the gate when you offer some thanks. Come on and give God some thanks. He ain't no rubber at the gate. He said, if you want to get past the gate and come on into the court, you got to give me some praise. But I'm not satisfied just being in the court. I don't want to just stop in the court. I want to get to where he is before the throne room. And in order to get there, we first have to offer up that praise, and then the praise will take us into his glory. Thank you, Pastor, because we were right there. We were right there at the glory. Thank you for doing that. It was, as I said, you could have just stood here and waited. Because when you get at the glory and into the glory, if you will wait for him, he will speak. If you'll wait. But we are not accustomed, especially in this generation, to spend time waiting. The whole society now is geared toward get it, get it quick. I hardly go to the store to buy anything other than groceries, because I can just do Amazon and it's on my porch the next day. I love it. You don't have to wait for stuff to arrive. And they even got same day delivery. We're used to getting things in a hurry, but God said, wait. And again, I say, wait. So as we, just in that little brief encounter that we had, when Pastor ushered us in to his presence, in that brief encounter, I heard God say, yeah, I wanted you all's attention. Ask him, do I have your attention now? What he told Rebecca, he said, you said you see, really? He said, pay attention, because you really don't see. He said, ask him, do I have your attention now? And then he said that when, this is why I'm sitting there in praise. It came to me. He said, all that commotion when Elijah was in the cave was to be sure I had his attention before I showed up. He made all the commotion and the noise to be sure Elijah was paying attention before he showed up, because when he showed up, he wasn't going to make that kind of commotion. He was going to speak to him. in a way that he could understand and to make it plain. Thank you, Jesus. And so, tonight, I want to speak and make it plain now. Turn to Ephesians 1 and 17. What the intent of God, I heard him, even in just those few moments, I heard him say, yes, it has gotten chaotic because I want to be sure that you all know you're not in control. I'm taking it out of your control. I'm putting you in places and circumstances and things where you cannot control. Because I'm forcing you to turn to me and recognize me because he's got the key. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Ephesians 1 and 17, are you there? If you are there and you have King James, would you lift your voices as one and read 17 and 18, please? Would you read 17 again? Stop right there. That the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and this is where we stand tonight. He's ready to give us wisdom and understanding in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Wisdom is having the information and knowing what to do with it when you get it. And understanding is self-explanatory for us in the sense that you can understand with your intellect, but he wants us to move past an intellectual understanding just as he did with Habakkuk, when Habakkuk said, I see, and God said, oh, really? The word that Habakkuk had used for see was to see with his mind and understanding. And God was letting him know, your intellect cannot understand what I'm doing. I need to give you a spiritual insight and understanding so that not only do you get what I'm doing, but you know what your role is in this. That the God and Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ might give us what? The spirit of wisdom, knowing what to do with what you know, and understanding, going past our minds and aligning our thoughts with his, so that we have enough spiritual sight to align with God and obey, even if our intellect is not getting it. Did that make sense? Even if your mind doesn't understand why God told Moses, take off your shoes, you're standing on holy ground, at least you have enough spiritual sense to do it anyway. There was a purpose to God telling him that. I've already taken them off, and I'll get to that momentarily. But the eyes, he said, I want God to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation, so that the eyes of your understanding will be enlightened. Eyes there was actually talking about the ability to have sight. The word there was very similar to our word in English, ophthalmology. It was ophthalmos, the eyes. But when he said being enlightened, that word was photizos, which is like photography. So what he said was, I'm praying that God will give you the spirit. I want you to wait long enough for him to give you the spirit of wisdom and understanding spiritually, so that with your spiritual eyes, you can take a snapshot. You get a vision of what God is talking about when words are inadequate. Because one picture is worth a thousand words. This is what God did with Joseph when he had a dream about his future. God showed him a picture of what was to come. Thank you, Jesus. And that picture gave him courage and hope to endure the things that were going to happen between the now of getting the picture and the time when it became manifest. One of the seers, one of the prophetesses, has said, she said, all of us can see visions in the spirit. She said, all of us don't know how to recognize them and catch hold to them when they come. And then she described it and understood what she was saying, because I didn't consider myself as one that has visions. She said, we don't realize, we don't have understanding of what they are. She said, but when you are praying or when you are worshiping, and sometimes something just flashes. She said, you almost saw it, or sometimes you did see it. She said, you can learn how to capture that and hold on to it because you realize what it is. So you recognize and respect it, and you can train your mind to hold on to what God is showing you. Just like you can train yourself to hear his voice. And you can tune your ears to recognize when he's speaking from yourself. So you don't always have to question, is this the Lord? You can exercise yourself unto righteousness. So this is what he says in Ephesians. This is a prophetic prayer that he prayed over the body of Christ, which means that we can declare it, and I declare it over this house, that our God and Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, I declare that tonight he is releasing a spirit of wisdom and understanding in this house, that he is opening up your spiritual eyes so that you can see in the spirit and capture what God is speaking into you. If you believe it and receive it, lift your hands and say, yes, God. Now hold your hands back up right there. Just hold them up right there and say, Father, I believe it. I receive it even now. Show me again. Stay right there a second. Show me again. I just want to see if you're going to recognize a flash. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You can put your hands down. We just don't always recognize it. I say it while we were praising. I suddenly envisioned Elijah in the cave, and then God said, I got his attention before I came. That's what I was doing. All that was happening, going on while you were singing. And to me, it was just like, oh, I just thought about Elijah. No, you didn't. He sent you this, because then he said, ask them now, do I have their attention? He was speaking. Praise takes you into the glory, and the glory will give you revelation. This is what you want. You should come to church prepared to get into the revelation of God. You should come to church prepared to praise and to set, this is what it means, set the atmosphere so that the glory can come and God can start to speak. And he can get very personal with the speaking. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You want someone to prophesy a word into you, that's all right. But he can prophesy to you himself. He can speak into your spirit and encourage you and tell you what he wants you to know. Do I have a witness? Oh, but it's good when he does give a confirming word to someone else. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. You were singing all the right songs to get us there, Pastor. All the right songs. My daughter had said to me last night, she said, Mom, I got to commend you for what we have gone through, for what you've been through. So I thought about all that you're still doing. We said, and I thought about it, I was like, she said, Mom, you're an iron woman or something, because you do not portray what really be going on. I said, because I'm representing my Lord. I'm a king's kid. She said, well, you act like it's all right. I said, it is all right. I'm not playing. It's all right. Because I trust God. I trust in him. I said, and I know what to do when it starts to try to, I said, honey, I have learned ever since we got in this deep water, do not look down. Keep your eyes up and keep on walking till you get out of this storm. I said, and some days I wake up and I'm not looking up, and all I do is just, I get up early, I go get a cup of coffee, and I just sit in the den in the dark sipping that coffee, trying to get a grip on the day. And then this ain't the way this is going. Let me pull my mind out of this. Somebody described it as, I can feel myself, this is what they said, it seems like a dark cloud is coming over me that wants to suck me in and focus me on what is not going right. Habakkuk's situation was, he kept looking at the negative, and he was rehearsing to God everything that wasn't right and said, and I don't see you doing nothing. God said, oh, is that right? Oh, really? Well, I guess not if all you're doing is looking at the dark, because I'm over here working and you're looking over there. You need to open your eyes and see what I'm doing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Come on, put your hands together and bless him. Thank you, Jesus. So the first thing that God wants us to get and take from here, from these services, is refocus your vision. Refocus your vision. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Refocus your vision. I confessed to my daughter, I said, oh, but the change came. You see, God was, as he said, as he spoke in the worship, he said, I let things get chaotic on purpose. He's breaking our paradigm, breaking my paradigm, pulling control away from me so that I couldn't do nothing but rely on him. I don't like not having control. Who wants to not have control over what's happening? I mean, and he pushed the point. He pushed the point so hard, Mika, till one day the fit broke, the next day the second vehicle broke, and the third day the Lexus broke. And I was like, oh, my God, what are you doing? Oh, and then the appliances started breaking, and then this started breaking. And I'm calling people trying to get them, okay, don't hear back. I'm like, what is happening? And I said, this is spiritual harassment. When everything looks like it's just going haywire, and then you trying to get out, and nothing is working. You call in the right people for the right help, and they don't come through. And I'm like, what can I do? And one day, I was sitting in the study, and I was just sitting there thinking. And I was like, oh, how many things is it that need to be done? Huh?
And I'm not used to doing them all. And Craig used to do this, this, this. But now, let me see, how am I going to work this, this, this? And then I start laughing. I said, all right, Father, you know I do not know. I have no control over this. I'm not going to worry about this. I'm just going to carry on my business. I just did like a bet. I'm fixing to do what I'm supposed to be doing for you, and I need you to handle the other stuff. I said, and I'm just going to go on however long it takes. It's all right, because I still got it good. I'm, you know, all is well. All is well. I just need this stuff done, but it's okay. However long you take, that's all right with me. I got it. I'm good. And I just got up and started going on about my business. And immediately after that, prophet came to the church, and when he prophesied, he said, and what God is sending to Faith Kingdom, and he began to prophesy it, he said, oh, and he said, not only here at Faith Kingdom, but at your house, Sister Craig, the renovations and all that you need done, you gonna get that, even the kitchen that you want. I said, ooh, I didn't tell nobody that, but God, that is you. He said, ladies, you ought to start shouting, because if he spoke it to her, he knows what's going on with you too. Come on and give God a praise, because he's letting you know, I know where you are. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And from the moment he said it, I mean, I was so excited, because I was like, God has spoken. Oh, yes, God has spoken. And the man even said, and it will be this year. And so in my mind, I was like, okay, it's already October, and the spirit is 2017. God got to next year in October to work it out. Can I tell you that almost everything on my list is done now? God didn't do what, y'all catch what I'm saying. October, 2 months ago, I think I have X'd out everything that I had on the imperative list that I could not do. Two months. Two of the things that I was stuck with for about 6 months. Two different things that I was stuck with. They showed up at 8 o'clock that morning, 12 noon. Both men said, we through. I'm like, oh, my God. How much time did I lose fretting over this? And you could do it like that. But you did it when you got ready. But you didn't do it till I just gave it over and I just said, I'm going to praise you. I'm through with this. You in control. I'm not in control. I got it, and I just magnify you. Come on and magnify it. And on top of that, the man of God said, I know it's been a hard year, but God said you owe me a praise. Hallelujah. How many of you owe God a praise? Come on and give him the praise right now. I was touched that he even acknowledged he knew it was hard. I thought that was so sweet. He said, I know. It's been a hard year. I let it be hard. Oh, but you owe me a praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can somebody just jump up and give him a praise now, right here? Like Sister Queen Esther said, just take a praise break right there. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Be seated. Thank you, brother. I know you for real. I'm not cheerleading up here tonight. Ha! Thank you, Jesus. Because where we are is too real. We need too much real help. And ain't no need of somebody coaching you into doing nothing. You're going to have to recognize this is real. That's why I'm sharing with you what God said, what God did, because he proved he's right here, right here, right now, in this house, present, right now. God is in all places. meeting all needs. Y'all hear it, you know it. Come on and sing it. He's doing all things, and he's doing them well. God is in all places. He's meeting all needs. He's doing all things, and he does all things well. Thank you, Jesus. Refocus. Come on, put your hands on your eyes. Father, in Jesus' name, hallelujah. I pray that you will touch our spiritual eyes even as we touch our natural eyes. You would clear up the vision, and you would go inside and help us to refocus our spiritual vision to see what you are doing. And even if we cannot see and articulate what you're doing, we see your grace and your mercy and how strong it is over us. Because no matter what we've been going through, someone would love to trade situations. We may have lost one, but somebody lost two. Hallelujah. We may have lost two, but somebody lost three. Hallelujah. And we thank you. Come on, put your hands together and bless him right there. So the first thing to take away is to refocus your vision. The second thing is reassess your watch, W-A-T-C-H, and align yourselves properly. If you've been here, then I'm still talking about Habakkuk. After Habakkuk challenged God lovingly and God was gracious enough to deal with him and answer him, then Habakkuk's response was, all right, then I get it. I'm going to stand up on my watch and I'm going to see what the Lord will say. And he was saying it so that he would know what to do. He was a watchman, and probably the reason that Habakkuk saw negativity so strongly is because he was in the season wherein night watchman stand. A night watchman is the one that stands on the watch during the darkness, the dark time. Now, I need for you to listen to me closely and the eyes of your understanding be enlightened. I said this point was reassess your watch, reassess your position, and realign yourself with what God says your position should be at this time. He was a part of the third watch. Third watch is that dark watch for his nation. He was a part of the third watch. We're now in the fourth watch. How do I know that? And I hope you got understanding so that I don't, because I'm not going to, some things I'm just going to do like God. I'm just going to cut it short in righteousness and abbreviate. So some things I leave out thinking you already know. All right? So I'm referring to the watches of the night because Jesus refers to them. He said, what if he comes in the first watch or the second watch or the third watch? Now, the interesting thing is the fourth watch is the watch in which daybreak comes at the end. It is from 3 to 6 o'clock in the morning. It includes the darkest time of the night. But this is where the gatekeepers are important. Because the unique thing about the fourth watch is it is the only watch where you have watchmen and gatekeepers present at the same time. Because the night watchman is there to watch the dark for adversaries and enemies and sound the alarm and to guard the gates.
But as the sun is beginning to break and about to rise, the gatekeepers come on during that last hour to determine when it's light enough. They are watching the sunrise, and when it's light enough, then they have the authority to open the gates for the day so that business can be transacted. Now, the interesting thing is that in Scripture, for whatever God's thoughts are, God loves to rescue his people and deliver them in the fourth watch. The Scripture says he watched Pharaoh's army chasing Israel, and he saw them have Israel backed in a corner. And it says that God watched, and at the fourth watch, he said, I will deliver them now. And he got up at the fourth watch and took the wheels off of Pharaoh's chariots and delivered Israel. The Bible says Jesus watched his disciples toiling with the boat in the night, and then he started walking on the water at the fourth watch. He said, oh, I'll go get them now. Why he wait for the fourth watch, I don't know. But this is my point. If you are a night watchman, if you have been charged by God to call out wickedness, call out evil, looking for the adversary, always looking in the darkness and calling it out, because it is an assignment. You better ask God about your assignment at this time, because we are moving into the daybreak. We're moving to the sunrise, where the sun, S-O-N, is getting ready to rise with healing in his wings, and the star of the morning star, is getting ready to rise, and the light is getting ready to shine, and the gatekeepers are going to open the gates, and the people are going to flood into the kingdom of heaven, and there's going to be a great revival. So why did I say ask God about your assignment? Because if the light is coming and all you still doing is looking at the dark and calling out darkness, you're going to be left behind. Your assignment needs to shift or you're going to be of no use. Hallelujah. 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 There is a time to call out sin. It's a time to challenge the people. It's a time to chastise. And it's a time when God says, I have come to deliver. They need to be encouraged. Comfort ye my people. It's not time to cry. It's time to rejoice. Stop looking at the challenge. See Jesus coming. Hallelujah. Reassess your assignment before you get left behind. Jesus, when my understanding became enlightened, I said, Lord, I know I love to call out the darkness. Oh, yes. I love righteousness, and I love to call it and put that plumb line out there. I said, but oh, I don't want you to leave me out of this season. Change my vision. Help me to not see everything that's wrong and start to see you moving in grace and you moving in dynamic ways. Help me to realize that what you said before, it was all right for them, but now you're saying, I'm moving in a new way. I'm breathing. I'm sending a new word. I'm sending a new message. If I change the message and you keep saying what you've been saying, you're going to find yourself talking to yourself. Hallelujah. Lift those hands. Lift those hands. Hallelujah. Oh, God, lift your hands. Father, open the understanding. This is what he meant when he said, I'm breathing new life. I'm breathing new life. I'm breathing new life. And when we've been faithful to our assignments, we find it hard to believe he's switching. The nation of Israel couldn't believe he was switching. How'd you have us do all these things? Then you said these people coming out of grace. Well, we're going to put some of this written down, so they need to do some of what you made us do. That's what they said, right? Okay, I'm talking as if you know what I'm talking about. Jesus's disciples, who became apostles, had such a hard time believing God on the day of Pentecost. He breathed a new season. And in this season, not only did Jews start speaking in tongues as the Holy Ghost breathed through them, but people from all different nations and tongues who had not kept their laws, who had not honored what they had done, who hadn't offered sacrifice, who wasn't circumcised, they were speaking in tongues just as strong as them who had done all of that. And the apostles had a problem. When they met, they had a council that said, some of these things we did, they gonna have to do. Now, which ones will they have to do? And other than saying, don't wring a chicken's neck and eat the chicken anyway, I don't know what else they came up with. Well, tell them don't eat stuff strangled with blood in it. I mean, just trying to think of, we have to do this, somebody got to do it. What am I saying? I'm saying I hear the Lord saying, and he said in this place himself, I am breathing new life. Thank you, Lord Jesus. That means he's sending a new season. When the wind comes, the season shifts. When the winds come, I said the other night, I'll just repeat it now because some may not have been here. The massive chaos, the massive losses and damage that we're being sustained with right now is because the kingdom of God give me five brothers up here real quick. Very quick, five brothers. I ain't gonna have you do anything you can't do. You won't have to levitate or do anything like that. The kingdom of God is advancing. Come on this side, please. I need one more. Thank you, brother. Turn facing me because you'll need a little space there. Now line up beside each other. Thank you, thank you. All right. Let me have you on this side, brother. Get you on this side, and y'all shoulder to shoulder. All right. Back up a little bit. All right. Lift your hands up so that you can be identified. You're the quarterback. Okay, I know a little bit about football. Y'all see me at the Cowboys game Monday night on Facebook? That was Giselle's Christmas present to her daddy. Bought that suite right there on the yard line. We could reach out and feel the grass. And they were surprised because I knew a little something. I said, all of a sudden, something came to my remembrance because we had a little old raggedy electric football game when we were little. And I used to do that. But I don't like to spectate. I like to participate. So that's why I don't do all that now. But as something came to me, I said, if they get 10 yards, it's a first down getting right. And I said, Mama. You know that? I said, I used to know. But from that, God gave me this. The kingdom, you all lock elbows, okay? Now, I know football players don't lock elbows, but I want you to lock elbows, okay? All right, now, give me some women. Y'all won't mind me using you. Give me four women quickly. The kingdom of God in front of these four brothers. In football, what would they be called if that's the quarterback? Uh-huh. Uh-huh. These men represent the kingdom of God. This is the Lord Jesus Christ coming through. He's preparing to make his appearance on the earth. And that's why you hear me sing that little piece of Micah Stanley song, "The kingdom is coming by the will of the Father. Hallelujah to his name." Because I love that line. "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." As the Lord's kingdom is advancing, brothers, when you take one step forward, hit the ground hard so it make a noise. Do your left foot first. Yeah, left foot first. All of y'all step forward with your left foot and hit it. Whomp. Yeah. When the kingdom advances, Satan immediately sends the offensive, defensive, for the territory that he has stolen. And so, y'all push a little closer too. You take a little step forward. Mm-hmm. And the kingdom keeps coming because God is not going to be defeated. Take another step forward. Oh, yeah, y'all scared to do that, huh? Turn your back, man. Turn your back, sis. I really should have done this the other way for what I want to do. But what I want to show you is this. Okay, yeah, it's all right. It would have been better if I turned it the other way. And I think I will. Yeah, go the other way. Come on, Jesus. Turn the other way. No, face the ladies. You're still facing. But the reason I have you doing this, I had it right first time, Madam Clerk, is because if they represent the Lord Jesus Christ, this is what I want you to see. Okay.
It's mom and son.
All right. What I want you to see is this. While the quarterback is making his way through, start coming closer and start coming to find, to push your way through, but don't do it. Just be making the moves of coming closer. As these defensive linemen protecting the satanic territory, the kingdom of God advancing, they push back against it. Now, I just want you to take her hand, and I want you to go down on your knee. That's what happens in football, doesn't it? They will wrestle the player down that's in their way, but they really, their point is they want to stop the quarterback. Y'all get that? Uh-huh. And brother, take her hand and just give it a little shake, and sis, go down on your knee. Uh-huh. Because they're wrestling. But they're not going to be able to stop him from coming through. Push back. Because they're going to advance. Push back. Push back. Push back. Uh-huh. All right, thank you. Here's what I'm saying. This is what has been happening in the spirit. The kingdom of God is advancing, and though they cannot stop, thank you, though they cannot stop the Lord from advancing, we see persons, intercessors, saints of God, who are defending the gospel, getting wrestled down in their protection and their assignment while the kingdom is still advancing. So the hotter the battlefield gets, the hotter the game gets, the more intense the struggle gets. So then we say, how did brother so-and-so fall down to affliction? How did he get taken out? He was just defending his piece of territory. And the enemy came against, he took him down. But he's not stopping the kingdom. The kingdom is still going forward. And the battle is getting hot. It's getting so hot, we keep seeing even saints of God being taken out because the enemy is fierce to stop, but he cannot stop the kingdom of God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Even him hitting Elder Craig as the quarterback wasn't enough to stop the kingdom. We just got some more quarterbacks, the second quarterback took position. And we kept on pushing forward. You do not stop when some fall down. That's a part of the thank you, Lord Jesus. And so when we go through, we never should say, why me? What do you mean, why me? Paul gave his life. Peter gave his life. They gave their lives. And so this that we suffer is not worthy to even be named among the glory that is to be revealed. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Reassess the position that you're called to. Reassess where you're standing. And for you to know what you should be doing at this point, this is what I want you to do. This is what God told Moses and Joshua to do. Moses had been given an assignment, and Moses tried to control it and do it, and it failed. I think we're all aware of where I am with that. And God sidelined him so he could refocus him and we could realign him. I found it interesting that one of the intercessors here told me they had a dream, and they said in the dream they saw their intercessors and Faith Kingdom's intercessors, and they saw them getting ready to merge, and they said, and Sister Craig, you were watching, but you were on the sideline. I said, and that's just exactly, that's where I am. I said, I recognize that from many of the things that I normally do, and it's in my heart to do, God has sidelined me because he's shifting my assignment. And by him shifting my assignment, even though actually it may be a greater one, I still prefer what I was already doing. But he has sidelined me, and I said, I need to hurry up and readjust, don't I? So that I'll be in alignment with you, and my way won't be so hard. Can you follow me? Paul thought he was doing the right thing, and God had to stop him and say, no, let me stop, let me readjust you. Because you think you're doing a good work, but that's not what I have for you to do now. So let me just stop you and sit you down a minute, and I'm going to refocus you. And he actually took his sight away to totally stop him. It doesn't mean we were doing the wrong thing. I just told you that. It's just that when God blows and sends a new season, then he's wanting us to shift, and he needs for us to shift what we're doing with him. So Moses went up to the mountain, and God got his attention. I know I'm not the only one that God got your attention on this year. And not just a 12-month year, but in the past several months of season. 1, 18, 24, getting our attention. He got Moses' attention with the bush, and then God called him out by name. He didn't scream at him. He breathed at him. And because the roots of the bush were in the ground and the glory of God was in the bush, it empowered and sanctified the ground with his glory. And God told Moses, why did he tell him to take off his shoes? Because Moses was a shepherd. But God was shifting his assignment. In the Hebrew tradition, the priests wear their shoes for everything they do in the temple until they get ready to minister before God in the holy place. When they get ready to go into God's presence, they must take off their shoes to come into his presence. One is a sign of humility. Another is a sign of releasing all that they have. Even as when Boaz got ready to take Ruth, the one who had title to her took off his shoe to say, I'm letting her go. So when we get ready to come before him, he said, I need you to take off everything. I need you to let everything go. And the other thing is, when you come before me and I'm getting ready to shift you and empower you, then I don't want anything insulating or protecting you from my glory. In the same way that rubber protects you from electricity. That word take off meant peel back like bark. So the glory of God, the anointing was in the ground, and God said it can't get in you till you first take off what you got covering you, protecting you from me. Take that off, and then I can empower you with the anointing. And it was when Moses took off the shoes that God said, yeah, now let's check it out. Because the anointing was there in the ground, and he had to be sanctified, consecrated, and empowered to be commissioned for the new assignment. So he told Moses, now put your hand in your breast. Let me see how well that took. And so when he put it in and he took it out, God said, what you see? He said, leprosy. He said, yeah, that's what I said. Put it back in. All right, take it out. What do you see? It's clean now. God said, all right. That meant that the download was successful, and you have taken on my anointing and my glory. Now I'm going to give you a new assignment because you are empowered. I called you as a baby to be a deliverer, but I just gave you the power to do what I called you to do. Now this is your new assignment. Go tell Pharaoh. I don't need you to fight nobody like you tried to fight and get them free. Simply tell Pharaoh, let my people go. That's your message. That's all you got to say. That's it. All these years of preparation were just so you could say, let my people go. Because the message seems short, but it's real dangerous. It's real dangerous to go in Pharaoh's face and say, my God said, the source of your economy is in these people and on their backs. And God said, let my people go. Four words. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm drawing to a close. He did the same thing with Joshua. When he got ready to commission Joshua to actually lead that army and win the war, the same thing was told him, take off your shoes. Give up all your protection. How do we protect ourselves? How do we protect ourselves from other people? What do? Refuse to participate so we won't be disappointed. Some people refuse to make a commitment, even in marriage, because they're afraid. Some people even express, I will never be hurt again. How do we protect ourselves from one another as saints? What do? We won't confess. Because we're afraid somebody will misunderstand our confession? How do we, how do you? What would God tell you? I need for you to take that off. What would he say? I need for you to take off that drawback that every time I get ready to do something with you, you hedge. Oh, I need for you to take off that pride that before I can tell you, you've already run forward. I need for you to take off that you need a whole group to go with you to do what you're going to do because really you insecure. I need for you to take that off. You don't need nobody but me. We have all kinds of mechanisms that we don't even acknowledge to ourselves. What prevents you from going forth in what God has given you as gifts and your calling? What is it you're covering up? What is it you're insulating yourself with? And God is saying, no, I am getting ready to shift the season. And I need for you to take off your shoes. Because you will never be able to do what I'm going to do if you don't have power. And I cannot empower you if you're going to close up and protect yourself from me. If you're afraid to let the Holy Ghost use you. You want me to speak, but you're afraid to say what I tell you. Hallelujah. You want to lay hands, but you're afraid to put your hand on someone. You're afraid it won't come to pass, or they won't be healed, or that won't happen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And so, here we are. In 2016, the significance of that year was the year of the pig. And out of all the things I heard said about pigs, a pig is also used to identify a new water source. Wherever they found new water, they put a pig. And then they came and dug a well. And then the people came because there was water to sustain them. And then they called a priest to be there in that place with them. In this last season that began and is ushering us into 2017, God has been setting pegs in churches. Lighthouse is one, because God said, I'm breathing new life. He's validating what he's doing. He spoke the same thing into Faith Kingdom, I'm breathing new life. He spoke the same thing in Muskegon, Michigan when I was there. He said, I'm breathing new life. God is choosing the water spots where he wants the intercessors that are already at work digging new wells, and God is anointing them as priests. There are even those, this is not just for us as churches, but there are those who are calling themselves now intercessory missionaries, and they are going out digging wells where there is water, establishing houses of prayer all around the world. And their assignment, Sister Janice, I see you doing it. They are training intercessors to go in and take territory and dig wells wherever God says, here is water, dig here. And then he says, raise up an intercessory group. Here is water, dig here. And God is digging new wells. And God is commissioning us. 5777, 2017 is the year going from being called to being commissioned and sent. From being called to being empowered to do the work. Thank you, Jesus. Stand to your feet. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. raise your hands right there. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you. The Spirit of the Lord is already in the place. But there are some that may have. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Missed the entrance as we went in. Would you lift your hands? Hallelujah. Lift your hands. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord is in this holy temple. Oh, the Lord is in this holy place, and I will bless his name. I'll bless his name, for he has done great things for me. Come on, I'm just helping you enter back. Thank you, God, the Lord is in his holy temple. It's talking about our bodies. It's not just talking about the building. The Lord is in this holy place, and I will bless his name. I'll bless his name, for he has done great things for me. The Lord is in this holy temple. Oh, the Lord is in this holy place, and I will bless his name. I'll bless his name, for he has done great things for me. Come on, I want you to just lift your hands right there. Listen, 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 listen. Hallelujah, Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I want all the worshipers, I want you to take your position in him and begin to worship. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Begin to worship. Begin to worship. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Let your rhema words saturate and go down into the spirits, even beyond that I spoke, God. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. We acknowledge what you said, that the season is shifting. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on and stand before him in the holy place. I dare you to take your shoes off if you're serious. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, because we are about to release. Thank you, Jesus. Release the empowerment of God. Father, we have given your word that you have put in our hearts for this place. All week, you worked with us patiently. We thank you. We thank you while you broke us down and you showed us how we didn't really see correctly what was going on. And you explained to us again how you are the one in control. And you let us know that our praying is being heard. You let us know that the things we see happening, both good and bad, are the result of our praying, because as we're praying, your kingdom is advancing. Father, we acknowledge that you also said that you are doing a quick work, and because of the time, you're having to abbreviate it and make shortcuts. Hallelujah. And we acknowledge that you said the vision is being released. It is breathing now, and time is no longer delayed. That is why you must make shortcuts. Father, we acknowledge that you are sending us notice and you are sending us warning that in this season, no one is exempt. It is imperative that we make our calling and election sure. It's imperative that we reassess our assignment, that we reassess our position, that we be sure that what we are seeing is what you are showing us at this time. And that where we cannot understand, our hearts are fixed in faith on you, where we can just say, yes. Yes to what I don't understand. Yes to what I don't like. Yes to what I don't agree with. We say yes to your choice of a national leader. We say yes to Donald Trump, because promotion comes from the Lord. And so we say yes. We say yes to what you're doing around the world, what you're doing with ISIS. We say yes to the chaos that's increasing. We say yes, and we recognize that the more we pray, the fiercer and the more intense the game is becoming. And we say yes, and we take our position, and we press forward. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We say yes if you say, I need to sideline you while I build you up. I need to sideline you while I prepare you. We say yes to that. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We say yes to revival. We get ourselves ready to receive those that are going to bust through with force. We say yes to the filling of the house. We say yes to the consecrations it takes to help them be delivered. We say yes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 We say yes as you shift directions. Thank you, Jesus. We say yes as you sever ties and relationships. We say yes as you network us in a new way. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We say yes as you align us with people we never expected to be aligned with. People who don't worship like we worship, we say yes. People who don't necessarily talk like we talk, we say yes. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. Yes, to your will, Lord, and to your way. Oh, yes, Lord, I will obey. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. One of the things I heard as I came tonight, one of the things I heard in my spirit was, God said,
tell those ready for the shift and to be commissioned for where I'm breathing the new life, the new season. Tell them to take off their shoes. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And in taking off your shoes, you're saying, I'm ready to be commissioned. And this is not saying, well, I'm already a preacher, I'm already a missionary. This is not saying that. This is saying to what God is about to send you on your new mission. And to say sin doesn't mean to go out and establish a building somewhere. It means to accept the assignment that he has purposed for you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you're ready to be commissioned, get into the aisle immediately in front of me. Move quickly. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And this is not just a mass carpet prayer line. Thank you, Lord Jesus. God took his time to get us to the point of accepting what he was saying. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. He took his time to prepare us for this. Hallelujah. And listen, 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 beloved. I need for you to understand what I'm saying. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I need for you to understand. This is real life that we're talking about. This is real life. This is real life. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is real life, Sister Clerkley. Thank you, Jesus. Shaka Baba say. God took 3 nights to get us ready for that little bit I said tonight. Oh, can't you see how chaotic it is? And he wanted you to understand the chaos because he wanted you to know that you are victorious through it and you have power over it. Don't forget he spoke blessing in the midst of. I told you how he pronounced blessing for everything that I was going through because the season is now shifting. Where he's bringing me out of that dark time. But in bringing me out, I had to accept what he was saying, where he really wanted me to be, what he wanted me to do, and him saying, and I'm still going to do it my way. I'm just letting you know, you all right? You all right with me? You ain't doing nothing wrong? I can bless you mightily, and you still going through what I designated. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm just trying to help you understand what you're saying yes to. That you're saying, lift your hands. It is well with me. Hallelujah. It is well with me. What you're doing, what you're saying, I can do all things through Christ. Come on, say, I can do all things through Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Where are you standing? Lift your hands there. Lift your hands there. Lift your hands as high as you can lift them. Father, in the name of Jesus, even now as we stand before you in acknowledgement, in acceptance, in surrendering to what you have spoken. Father, as we surrender, even as you did with Moses and with Joshua, once they obeyed you and surrendered, you began to give them instruction and tell them specifically what they needed to do next. You began to download into them the strategy from your holiness. Oh, hallelujah. For some of us, the answer is going to quickly come. God said, when I flash it, catch hold to that vision. Catch hold to it.
Somebody, he's already speaking and flashing now. Catch up to it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If he's already speaking to you, tune me out. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Enter in on your most holy faith and begin to download the empowerment of God for your new assignment. Can't help you with this part. This is something you got to do. You got to enter in and download. You got to let God pour it down. Pour it, Spirit. Breathe. Breathe. Waiting for the download, waiting for the download to finish. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Waiting for it to finish, waiting for you to get it installed. Hallelujah, then I'm going to agree with you and we're going to open it. Hallelujah. The installation don't work unless you open it up. Thank you, Jesus. When you touch my hand, the Lord is going to open up what he put in you. The empowerment. Thank you, Jesus. All that you need. All that you need. Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 I'm listening for a sound. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you don't feel the glory, then hallelujah. If you don't feel the glory, don't move forward when the line moves. Hallelujah. Won't do any good. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because I'm not going to empower you. The Holy Ghost is doing that himself right where you stand. When you touch me, I'm just agreeing with you to open it and install it, to activate it in your spirit. But the download is happening while you stand. When you download it, push forward through the group and just come touch my hand to activate. Hallelujah. When you feel it happen, then you just come forward and touch. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God. Hallelujah. We release the glory. We release. Hey, I can empower you. Don't touch me unless you feel it. Woo, Jesus. How? How? Hallelujah. Oh. Katama. Receive it. Moses, check it out. See if it took. Check it out. Oh, hallelujah. Yeah. Help. Check it. Work. Check it out like Moses. See, did it work? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You need to open it and check it out to see, did it take? Thank you, Jesus. When God empowered Moses, he told Moses, check it out. See, did it take? Put your hand in and take it out. Ah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Whatever you to do, it installed right. Be sure that it installed right tonight. While the glory is here. Hey. Carl, why am I not making you dance? Because this power wasn't to dance. This was power to change. This was power to work miracles. This was power and anointing to go forth in his name. Just start moving through and check out your power. Lay your hands on somebody and see is your power there. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Did it take? Did it take? Can they feel it? Yes, yes, yes. I'm telling you, lay your hands on somebody. See if the Holy Ghost talks through you. Just see if he talks through you. You ought to be able to put your hand on somebody and he just talks through you. Yeah, the glory clouds in the room now. This is where I said when you wait, he'll start talking. Yes, hey, yes, come on. Come on, worship him right there. Yes, 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 yes. I heard the Spirit say, tell the one I'm talking to come and say it. He said, uh-huh. Because, yes, he said, I gave somebody a word. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And I need them to say it. Yeah, he's peeling off your drawback shoes. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Are those two young women from last night here tonight? Are they here? The young women that came down at the end of the message, are they here? Praise God. He says something. He was saying something. He's doing this for you, baby.
First night you came.
Thank you, Jesus.
When you said the Lord said he's going to give you greater than what you think you lost.
Thank you, Jesus.
He gave that to me before you even spoke it. So the Lord is going to give us greater than what we think we've lost.
Thank you, Jesus.
And that following Sunday, our guest minister came in, confirmed it again, talking about restoration. So saints of God, be not weary and well doing, God. Because if we if we faint not, we shall reap the promises of God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and put your hands together. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. He said, I am giving you greater than what you think you lost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, the glory. I know y'all got to come tomorrow night, so I'm not gonna tug on you. I really think the Holy Ghost has something else that he wants to do, but you would have to just go into it. Thank you, Jesus. Because tomorrow night is New Year's Eve. It's all right when you cooperate and you stay in it with him. But if somebody make you do it, then it's too much of a drain and you don't appreciate it when you leave. Oh, bless you, Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Holo shemene. I just heard him say again. He said, tell them to drink this in. I am feeding them for the journey ahead. Jesus. He said, drink and eat. Hallelujah. Like he told Elijah when he was running. He said, no, I had the angel to fix you something to eat. God said, I got manna in the house. Lift your hands up and in the spirit, just start drinking. All you can drink, all you can eat. God said, I'm spreading a table before you in the house tonight. And it won't last till tomorrow. Manna is only good while it's there. Thank you, Lord Jesus. He said, it's manna in the house. Eat, 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 eat. Eat all you can. Hey, supernatural strength for the journey. Supernatural strength for the assignment. Supernatural strength. Drink, babies, drink. Drink, open your mouth wide. How? He said, I'll fill it. Yeah. Open your mouth wide. And breathe. Breathe. Breathe in of the Spirit. Breathe in of the Spirit. Breathe on us, God. How? Fresh wind, send the wind, send the wind. Breathe, breathe, breathe on us, breathe on us, breathe on us, breathe on us. Fresh wind, oh God, yay, God. Here to heal you tonight. I know I broke you and wounded you, but I'm mending you back up. Eat and drink.
And I will bless his name. I'll bless his name. Yes, you have done. great things for me. For those things I will bless your name. I'll bless his name. For he has done great things for me. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. What do you say?
Sister Craig, remember when Sister Calhoun did the revival at your church? You gave me a word from God that he said, it is not his will that I suffer in my body. I've suffered in my body. Oh, I'm 45 years old. I've suffered in my body for 45 years. I was born with a kidney defect. And they did surgery in 2012. Well, in 2015, I began to have trouble again. They can't find the source of the trouble. Every time I talk to Sister Calhoun, I say, I hold on to what God said. Hallelujah. I'm going to, because if it's not his will, God, you're going to do something about it. And as I was meditating and I was asking God, God, don't leave me out of the season. I want to make the shield. I'm ready to do what you want me to do. And as I came through the line, and when we connected, the reason I miss Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, is because I've been in so much pain I could hardly walk to the bathroom. But I told Sister Calhoun today, I said, till yesterday, I said, I'm going to be at church tomorrow night because I refuse to be laying in my sick bed when 2017 come. So I even came to church and I was hurting, but I put a smile on my face and I did what I was supposed to do. And when you got ready, you told us to get in line, I said, oh God, I'm in so much pain. I just need to go lay down somewhere. But when I came to the line, God released all of it. Yeah. Yay, God, thank you. God is a healer, people. I don't care what you're going through. I don't care how long you suffer. God is a deliverer, and you better bank your money on it.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless him. Bless him. Praise him with us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Y'all got it. I know it's another service tomorrow, so I'm not holding you. I'm just going along with y'all. I'm just trying to see where you are, and then we'll move on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, Betty Johnson, you need to behave because you know you can. You run out all the time. You shout everywhere. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. But hallelujah, yes, ma'am, she does have healing. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's an anointed woman of God. I was just teasing her with that one. Thank you, Jesus. Because God delivered her from sarcoidosis. He delivered her from things doctors said she had and come back and they can't find them. And when she hurt him, she'd run the aisles and praise him anyway. And they'd be looking at her like, won't you sit down somewhere like what I just said. And when she get through, she'd be delivered and have a testimony. God heals her again and again and again. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I don't want to get in trouble with Elder Clerkley because y'all got to come back tomorrow night. That's New Year's Eve. Yeah, no, but I understand how it is. Thank you, Jesus. I said I'm going with them. If they were doing something else, then I would linger there, but I'm not going to press them. The Lord said to have you take your shoes off to be commissioned, and then he said, and tell everyone who gets commissioned to give me $77. Said, tell them to confirm their confidence in what I did with $77. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. So if you believe what I said all the other nights, then you believe that too. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Get your offerings in your hand. Thank you, Lord Jesus. If you're confirming it with the 77, get into the aisle so I can see. Thank you, Jesus. This is the same revival. The same revival. Hallelujah. And some may say, well, I gave that last night. God said, it's going to be some that say that. He said, but some of them are able to do it double. It'll make them no difference. They would have given more if you had asked. He said, so they'll give it again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. This is the same revival for when I ministered the offering and Sister Gail Fulbright came through with no job. She had lost a job and wasn't talking about it, but I knew. And so I told her, I challenged faith. I don't remember what I asked for, but I challenged her faith and I said, you don't need to go looking. You don't need a job. You need money. So believe God for that. And she gave whatever that was and went to her seat just rejoicing and cutting up and going on. You know, she hadn't been into a job since. And God, I told y'all, she worked from home. She make what she still makes top dollar, $40, $50 an hour, just do when she get ready to do. Ever since then, that's been years. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I believe that if you got $77 and you believe God's word, that you're getting in the aisle. I'm waiting on you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That you do quickly. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And we rebuke the enemy that comes to the mind. If you can't pass on 77, you won't be able to pass what God did. You won't be able to follow the commission. That's what we don't understand. God challenges us with things that are tangible so we can test where our hearts and faith really is. Hallelujah. So if you stumble at that when he confronts you with the real test, Sister Mayberry, when he confronts you with the real one, then you'll struggle there too. Hallelujah. But I know that the people of God believe God tonight. Hallelujah. And some don't have that. Thank you, Jesus. Then you get behind them with $35, a grace gift. You say, why 77? Because this is the mark of the year. This is the way God writes it out. He's dealing in the sevens. And so that's what he impressed upon me. You get in line with 35 if you don't have the 77. Thank you, Lord. Lift your hands. Father, thank you for breathing. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Hallelujah. This is still the spirit of worship. Thank you, Jesus. Lift your hands. Holy hands on holy ground in a holy place. And Father, we thank you. And we thank you. We know your people are faithful. And so we believe that those who are able to access it are being obedient to the challenge that you issued. And we thank you for that. Now, we thank you, too, for the others who don't have access to such, but they would if they did. And we thank you that they're going to give you from the riches of the treasure that they do have in the name of Jesus. And we thank you for them, too. We thank you for them all in the name of Jesus. And I pray, God, that the blessing announced upon me will be pronounced upon them, that the things that vex them that they cannot accomplish, where the enemy has harassed them, that by their obedience to you and the faith that they're manifesting tonight, you are going to pour grace over them and over everything they have, and you're going to begin to work it out in the name of Jesus. That even the confirmed word that the young woman brought, where you said, what we think we lost, you're going to give back more than that. I thank you for that in Jesus' name. I'm still waiting because somebody has that. I'm waiting on you. You didn't have 77, but you have 35. I don't want you to miss out on this. Thank you, Jesus. That's confirming when she said, give to you more than you lost. When I was sitting there, Pastor, one of the things that I was fretting over was a leak that I had over a new roof that I had had done on a new area that I had built for Pastor when he went down. And once I realized it was a problem in how they did it, I didn't have the money to do that twice. You know, to take it off, correct it. And so when I had said that to God that day, when I said, Lord, I have done what I can do. I'm through with this. Because you see me. You letting this stuff happen. I just trust you. You're going to get it all done when you get ready. And when that man of God released that, do you know the Lord dropped in your spirit, in my spirit? He said, just go ahead and have the thing priced to see what it take to replace it. Okay, I sent for a roofer. I said, I want you to check this out and see what would you just tell me what it costs to do this. And he said, is insurance paying for it? I said, nah. He said, why not? He said, cause yeah, need replacing. And not just that, you got other roof damage. He said, why don't you call your insurance company? I said, because I built this place. I said, it don't matter, it's part of your house now. Call your insurance company, your whole roof need replacing. I got a check. You know where I'm going. I'm telling you, I'm sitting there fretting over how to get this fixed. Not only did God fix it, but I got thousands of dollars left over after the fact, because God is able. God is in all places, meeting all needs. So I know you ain't struggling over $35. Hallelujah. But just in case you haven't been paid since Christmas, get into this line with whatever you have, because I know you didn't come before his presence empty, beloved. Thank you so much. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I know some really don't have it. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. But I also know how we do, though. We need challenging. Thank you, Jesus. I had to learn to give freely from Pastor Craig, because my dad was very pragmatic in his giving. He was a pastor, but he was pragmatic about giving. And Elder Craig was totally different, and I was like my dad. So Elder Craig was such a lavish giver, I wasn't used to that. But from his giving, I saw the blessing. I never really, I grew up in church, but I didn't equate giving really with being blessed, because I live in the pastor's house and I hear him talk. And so I heard what his attitude was about giving. And Dad's attitude about giving was, yeah, God gonna bless you one way or another. So what he would do is when he'd tell a person, gone on and tithe, gone on tithe and believe God, gone on tithe. If he made them go ahead and tithe, challenging them, he'd turn, sneak right around later and put the tithes back in their hand because he wanted to be sure that they got blessed. So in my little mind growing up, it was like, something funny with that. You did that. So now that means you don't really believe God would really do that he would do it, so you're going to help him be sure it get done so that it your word came to pass. So I learned from Pastor Craig how to just give out of the wazoo and see crazy stuff come back in. Amen. I've just learned how to, and then Bobby Henderson preached the gift of giving. The gift of giving. Ask God for the gift of giving, because lavish givers receive lavishly and they get things other people don't have. And I knew I didn't have that. So I said, God, I don't want to be calculating when I give and trying to figure and all of that. I want to give you lavishly. I want to be hilarious in giving. And I asked him to do it, and God blessed me to do that. Yeah, and you and your wife, both of y'all like that, Charles Craig kids. I'm telling you. And I know this church is too. I bless God for you, Lighthouse. I know you. I know you give. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So hold your gift up in the air. Oh, thank you. Thank you. God knows your heart, too. I just felt the anointing with that. He knows your heart, too. And what I hear him saying, what I hear him saying, I told you, learn to catch hold to the voice when you hear it and don't count it as your mind. What I heard him saying was, tell them the same way you called out those things that had you so frustrated and stumped and gave them to me. Tell them, call their things out to me with that gift. Just be sure it is really the blessing that I asked for that they're able to do. And I will honor that faith, and I am truly going to restore in that area that they're asking me more than what they're asking me to do. I'm going to prove that I was in the midst of giving. Go ahead and call that thing out. Speak it with your mouth. Nobody hear you because everybody's saying at the same time. Tell him the thing you need him to work on. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now lift your voice and thank him for it. Excited as I was when the man of God looked at me and said, God is releasing all that stuff for you. I got excited because I believe what he said, Janice. I was so excited. Oh, God heard me. He heard me. And that's important. Oh, wow. Thank you, Jesus. Come on and praise God. God just said he's going to do you the same way. Y'all maybe think you don't believe me. Come lay your gift on the altar with the same kind of joy. Thank you, Jesus.
I wanted to, Lighthouse, to recognize this testimony.
I just thank God for a lot. All week, I've been singing a song that Evangelist Craig was singing. God is in all places, and He's healing all things, and He's doing all things. And I started telling God, God, if you're in all places, you got to come. You got to do something because I need some help right here, right now. I'm tired. I'm done. I give it to you. I'm out of control. It's out of my control. So on today, Michael went to the doctor. Okay. Well, 11 months ago, out of nowhere, my son, my 8-year-old son, started having bowel issues. He couldn't boo-boo. He couldn't poo. He couldn't, he would just, it would come up instead of come out of his bottom. And so they couldn't find out what was wrong. They kept doing tests and tests and tests and tests. They couldn't find out what was wrong. We were admitted every 2 weeks, just about. If not every 2 weeks, every 3 weeks. Miss Tucker, he's backed up again. They started saying he has celiac disease. Celiac disease is when you you can't go. And so your small intestines becomes very, very blocked, and literally you're supposed to not be able to move. But I when they told me, I was just like, no, that can't happen because my baby still moved. My baby is artistic, so he's very, very active. He's very, very inquisitive. He does a lot. And so I said, no, that can't be it. I believe what y'all saying, but that can't be it. And so they gave me paperwork, started reading on and things like that. So come back 2 weeks later, he's backed up. So they say, Ms. Tucker, he can't have celiac disease because he wouldn't be backed up just like this again. So they put him on gluten-free diet. Gluten-free diet. I went out and spent over umpteen amount of money for gluten-free. Okay, so I tell the doctor, I say, well, he's still throwing up. He's still not pooing. And so this ain't working. So they say, okay, well, take him off the gluten-free diet. Took him off the gluten-free diet, put him back on regular food. So they say, well, Ms. Tucker, something got to be going on. I say, I agree. But I don't know what's going on. You all have to figure it out because I don't know. So then he's like, well, Ms. Tucker, we're going to do some more tests. So they admit him back in the hospital. Mind you, 12 months ago, I was working. I was working on the job. I ain't been working in 11 months. God has paid all my bills. He has been doing just everything for me, right? So, that's the background. Today, we go to the doctor. $7,400 for this surgery. Mind you, November the 1st, $7,400. Yeah, $7,400. On November the 1st, if he would have had this procedure before then, they would have paid for it. Mind you, we've been going through this 11 months. After November the 1st, on November the 10th, they switched his doctor to a different doctor. This doctor started doing, like, even more tests. And he was like, Ms. Tucker, they didn't do this test already? I said, no, they didn't do this test. So why are you doing this test? Well, this is the test they should have been doing. So he started doing more tests. And so he came, he said, well, Ms. Tucker, he's going to need an ACE button. And so this ACE button, it will help me to flush him out when he becomes blocked up because he does have, you know, issues with his bowels just because he's Michael, but there's help for him. And so they said, well, he's not going to be able to get it. He can get the ACE button, but he can't get the manometry test because Medicaid won't pay for the manometry test. So at this point, I'm like, okay, so what am I going to do? I start calling people. I start calling dad. I call a lot of people. I was just like, I don't know what to do. I don't have the money. So now my baby going to be sick. He going to stay sick. I don't know what to do. So I started doing resources, doing applications for grants and stuff like that. And, you know, I wasn't hearing anything. And so I heard some now about 2 weeks ago. And this lady, she called me. She said, Ms. Tucker, I got your information. I heard that you need, you know, your son needs this procedure done. Mind you, in all this, my house was flooded with sewage. So there was more money that I didn't have to do, you know, stuff with. But God has refurbished my whole house with everything and plus more. And so then, you know, we went to the doctor today. And so, the doctor come in the room. She say, well, Ms. Tuck, I got some good news for you. I said, well, you know, I'm listening.
And she say, well, Michael's going to be able to have his procedure done, but I need you to come up with amount of money, you know, this amount of money. And so first they told me I was going to have to come up with $1,970, because the grant was going to pay for all that, the other part. So I said, okay, well, you know, I'll start baking cakes and baking cookies, you know, trying to get up this money. So that wasn't working. I only got $25. And so I was like, okay, well, God, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm stuck again. So we're on to this week. Sister Craig, when she sung that song on Tuesday night, I just started singing it. I started singing it. I said, God, you got to be in this place. I'm a part of your place, so you got to be in this place. Michael's a part of your place, so you got to be in this place. You got to come in my house. My house is a new house, so it's refurbished. Exactly what Sister Delicia said, it's refurbished. It's new ground. I walked my whole house. I prayed my whole house. I said, God, you got to come in this place because we are part of you. And so, God, you know, after that, I said, well, I'm listening, doctor. She said, well, Miss Tucker, I need you to come up with $120. I said, that's all you need? I said, and my baby gonna have his surgery? I said, hold on. I got that gold purse. I start counting. I said, well, guess how much money I got in my purse? I said, I got $120 right now. My baby can have this surgery. So she said, Miss Tucker, say something. I say, well, when is the next availability for the surgery? She said, well, it won't be. It's about another year. I said, well, we already been going through this for a year. So he's going to be through this another 2 years? It's going to be 2 years he's going to go through this? I said, we can't be in the hospital for 2 weeks, or 2 weeks, or 2 weeks. We can't do this. No. I start singing, God is in all places. He's healing all things. He said, she said, Miss Tucker, you gotta talk to me. What you wanna do? I said, hold on. God is in all places. He's healing all things. And my baby, he starts saying, he said, Mama, you gotta talk to the doctor. You gotta talk to the doctor. And if you know Michael, he was getting my attention. He's trying to say, I'm ready to go. I don't wanna be here. And so I said, okay, doctor. Well, if we're not going to do it for another year, give me the date. She said, I'll be right back. She left out. And while she was out, I was just walking and singing. God is in our place. He's healing our things. And so my baby, he came and grabbed my hand, and he was walking with me. He said, God, you're all places? You're all places? I said, baby, it's God is in all places. He's hearing our things. He's doing her thing, baby. Just sing it with mommy. He starts singing, and the doctor came back in the room, and she's saying, well, Miss Tucker, I got good news for you, but I got some bad news for you. I said, give me the bad news. That's fine. She said, well, it's 2 weeks. Every 2 weeks, you're going to have to come in. He's going to have to get a clean out every 2 weeks, and this is going to have to happen 3 times. I said, okay, 3 times. We can do that. That's not a problem. She said, well, he'll have his surgery on January 30th.
Thank you.
My, my, my. Would you just look at somebody and say, God is too much God to accidentally bless you. If he blesses you, it's intentional. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Bless you, Lady Craig. Bless you. Thank you for being a servant. Thank you for being a servant. Thank you for just being a servant. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I still declare what you looking for, you looking at. And what you waiting on, ebonically, God been done it. Why you trying to figure it out? God been done it. By the time you figure out that he done it, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you, 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 thank you. Somehow they figured that out. The more you thank him, the more he bless you. The more you praise him, the more he comes in. They tell you he comes into a glad heart. They said, make your heart glad for the Lord. Make your heart be happy in your heart. Get happy. Begin to tell him, thank you. They said, say it faster, thank you, thank you. Say it faster, thank you, thank you, thank you. Say it faster, thank you, thank you, thank you. Say it faster, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, 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 thank you. Chris, to sit down. All right. Up there dancing and going on with her pregnancy. Well, listen, at least she got a reason for me to make her sit down. I don't know why you sitting down. I'm trying to sit up down because she's expecting it. I ain't trying to sit y'all down. I know what's supposed to happen tomorrow night. But I know what's going on right now, too. Hallelujah. My, my, my. We bless the Lord. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you, intercessors, prayer warriors, those that came and prayed this week. Thank you, praise team, those that came and ministered in song. Thank you, Lighthouse. Amen. And all of you, thank you, Faith Kingdom, for coming and being part of the revival. We thank God for you. All those that came, amen, not a part of Lighthouse or Faith Kingdom, amen. Dr. Yolanda Gamble is just part of us, so we don't acknowledge her in any special form or fashion. We just always thank God for her. I'm happy to see the ponytail again. Ponytail been MIA. I said something about a ponytail, and I ain't seen that ponytail in a while. I said, Lord, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to mess with her ponytail. I'm happy to see the ponytail. Amen. God bless all of you. We have enjoyed the Lord. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I had a terrible dream last night. It wasn't bad. It was just me. And I wouldn't have said nothing, but Sister Clerkley said, you know what you did? I said, what? She said, I turned to Sister Clerkley's cold natured. So when she gets cold, she, you know. Why are you supposed to tell that? Okay. Y'all, you know, y'all get cold, y'all put your, she said, I got there and I put my arm around you. You know what you did? You took my arm and put it down. And I said, well, thank you, sir. And I just turned over. I said, well, and I said, I had one of the most terrible dreams. And it was issues that frustrated. And I heard it in the word. You're going through it, but it's going to be all right. You are going to be, and then, did y'all see me standing over there? The Lord said, I called you away from them. Not, you know, I called you. y'all ever feel that lonely? Yeah, sometimes you, why can't I be with the crowd, you know, sometimes. So I called you. And then he made me stand there and watch. Like I need you. and then when Sabrina, Sister Kemp, when Sister Kemp got through, then he let me come back. So I don't need you. So, yes, Lord. So yes, Sister Craig, I got several answers. One just tonight for what happened last night in my dream. But I love him so much. I got that Jesse, the planet spirit on me. Hey, Jesus! Listen, you better love him. You better love him. And if anything, and our theme for 2017 is what? It's intentional. It's intentional. My service to God is intentional. All that I do will be intentional. My time, my talent, my treasure will be intentional. The time I give, it won't be an accident. The talent that I share that God has given me, it won't be an accident. The treasure that I have, and treasure for God is not limited to your money. There's more treasure. We have this treasure in earthen vessels that the glory may be of God and not of us. The treasure of your salvation, the treasure of your testimony, the treasure of the ministry God has put in you. What we do will be intentional. But then I heard God said, you know, all of it's intentional. When you go through, it's intentional. Just like when I bless you. But I made up my mind that whatever it is, I intend to be available, to be used. Amen. Tomorrow night at 10, amen. Some of the district churches are coming, and we're going to come, and we're going to begin prayer at 10 p.m., begin intercessory prayer at 10 p.m., and they're going to come in, and we've got some things outlined, and they're going to be part of that, and we're going to enjoy the Lord, and then we'll come back Sunday morning at 10 a.m., and we should, last Sunday we gave the benediction at 11:45. Yeah, we came in at 10, and we gave the benediction about 11:45, so we was out of here. Amen, amen. So we intend to do that unless y'all get to dancing, and then we may get out of here. Yes, Lord. Did you get happy, Sister Evans? Looked like she did. All right. I said, we may get, look like, oh, Jesus. I was looking right at you, Sister Evans. You know me well enough to know if I see something, I zero in on it. That's the Charles Craig in me. I am so guilty. I am so guilty. I love you in Jesus. Anything else, Sister Calhoun? Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Come on down. Sister Shante, Lady Clerkley, I just called your name out, Sister Clerkley. Stay in the spirit. Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Let us stand. Let us stand. Let us stand. Father, we bless you. We thank you for these nights of revival. Thank you for reviving, for refreshing, for renewing, for restoring. Thank you for every word, every word, every word, every song, every admonition, every exhortation, every prophetic utterance spoken this week. Help us, oh God, to capture, to capture, to capture. Hallelujah. Help us to capture that in Jesus' name. Now watch over us and keep us. Bring us back at the time appointed. Christ Jesus' name we ask and pray. Amen.